Peroxisomes participate in a number of processes. First of all, they participate in fatty acids catabolism. Peroxisome is the only organelle in human body that has the specific enzymes that provide the initial step in beta oxidation of very long chain fatty acids. It's the only organelle that is capable to oxidize them. The logic here is that mitochondria do not have enzyme to oxidize very long chain fatty acids. So they are initially delivered to peroxisomes, where they undergo peroxisomal beta oxidation. Peroxisome shortens them to medium chain fatty acid and binds to them coenzyme A. So peroxisomal beta oxidation results in production of medium chain length fatty acyl CoA. And now medium chain length fatty acyl CoA is delivered to mitochondria where it can undergo mitochondrial beta oxidation. Also, peroxisome is the only organelle that can provide alpha oxidation of branched chain fatty acids. The most common branched chain fatty acid is phytanic acid found in milk and animal fat. Recall that in a process of mitochondrial beta oxidation, the beta carbon of fatty acid molecule undergo oxidation. The concept is that branched chain fatty acids cannot be oxidized directly by beta oxidation because they have a beta carbon position methyl group that do not permit to oxidize this beta carbon. Exactly because of branched methyl group, they are called branched chain fatty acids. So the goal here is to make beta carbon position free, and peroxisomes solve this problem by peroxisomal alpha oxidation, simply by making beta carbon alpha carbon. So let's take phytanic acid. Phytanic acid initially is converted into phytanoyl CoA, and then peroxisomes oxidize alpha carbon, making an alpha position hydroxy group. That's why this process is called alpha oxidation. And right after oxidation, they immediately cleave formyl CoA, thereby the structure becomes one carbon shorter, with formation of pristanol, which is aldehyde. And as we see now, methyl group is located at alpha carbon position and beta carbon position is free. And to make fatty acid, aldehyde group is oxidized to carboxy group that results in formation of pristanic acid, which is fatty acid that has beta carbon position free. Also, we have to know that it's odd chain fatty acid. Recall that most fatty acids have even number of carbons. In our case, phytanic acid had 20 carbons. But after cleavage of formyl CoA, structure becomes one carbon shorter. That's why the end product, pristanic acid, has 20-1, 19 carbons. And because of that, this acid called odd chain fatty acid. And then, odd-chain fatty acids can be delivered to mitochondria where they will undergo mitochondrial beta oxidation. So, in the process of alpha oxidation, branched-chain fatty acids are delivered to peroxisomes where they undergo alpha oxidation that results in production of odd-chain fatty acids that then are delivered to mitochondria where they will undergo mitochondrial beta oxidation. Also important that peroxisomes participate in synthesis of cholesterol, plasminogens, which are membrane phospholipids that function as antioxidants, and peroxisomes provide both synthesis and degradation of hydrogen peroxide. So there are three important functions. It's cholesterol synthesis, synthesis of plasminogens that provide antioxidant defense, and also peroxisomes regulate metabolism of hydrogen peroxide. In addition to this, peroxisomes participate in other metabolical pathways as bile acid synthesis, catabolism of amino acids and ethanol. But the most important is that these two processes of fatty acids oxidation depend only on peroxisomes' functional state. And if something is wrong with peroxisomes, we have a huge problem because no other organelle in human body cannot deal with very long chain fatty acids and branched chain fatty acids. All human cells except erythrocytes contain peroxisomes, but liver and kidney have the highest quantity of peroxisomes compared to any other organ. And peroxisomal disorders affect every organ system where peroxisomes are present. And the higher the quantity of peroxisomes, the more severe will be the injury due to their dysfunction. To understand the pathology, we have to know how peroxisomes are formed. For a proper biogenesis of peroxisomes, they require peroxins, which stands for peroxisome assembly proteins. First of all, from the name, we already know that these proteins provide a proper assembly of peroxisomes. Basically, peroxins produce peroxisomal membrane that separates peroxisomes from the cytoplasm. And also, they provide instructions for making a protein called PEX1P, which stands for peroxisomal biogenesis factor. This protein regulates function of ATPases that provide input of enzymes into the peroxisome. And the production of peroxins is encoded by PEX genes. And we have three disorders that are related to dysfunction of peroxisomes. The first one and the most severe is Zellweger syndrome. Zellweger syndrome is autosomal recessive disorder that occurs due to a mutation in PEX genes, most commonly in PEX1 and PEX6. And this mutation disrupts formation of peroxisomes that cause severe disruption of peroxisomal biogenesis. It's the most common peroxisomal disorder that presents in early infancy and has the highest mortality rate among any other peroxisomal disorders. Now about the pathogenesis. If mutation in PEX gene occurs, it disrupts formation of peroxisomes, thereby it disrupts peroxisomal membrane formation and transportation of enzymes into peroxisomes. Basically, as a result, peroxisomes do not have any enzymes to digest anything, so they become completely dysfunctional. So, as we see in case of Zellweger syndrome, everything that could go wrong went wrong. That's why it's the most severe peroxisomal disorder that causes significant reduction or even complete absence of functional peroxisomes in tissues. First of all, because peroxisomes cannot oxidize very long-chain fatty acids, they begin to accumulate in tissues, particularly in fibroblasts. And also, very long-chain fatty acids enter into the circulation, and this results in an increase in the level of very long-chain fatty acids in plasma. Brain-chain fatty acids also cannot be oxidized. But in case of Zellweger syndrome, they are not the major problem. It's a tricky concept, and to explain this, we have to know that brain-chain fatty acids are present in our body in very low concentrations. So it will take 10 to 20 years for them to accumulate in tissues. And accumulation of very long-chain fatty acids in Zellweger syndrome will cause pathology in early infancy. So patients with Zellweger syndrome simply die before accumulation of brain-chain fatty acids will cause significant damage to tissues. Because peroxisomes participate in steroid metabolism, disruption of peroxisomal function causes decrease in biosynthesis of steroid hormones. Also with peroxisomal dysfunction, degradation of hydrogen peroxide decreases, so this will cause increase in reactive oxygen species, and also synthesis of plasminogen decreases, thereby antioxidant defense decreases, and together this makes tissue susceptible to oxidative injury. And abnormal accumulation of very long-chain fatty acids together with oxidative injury cause severe injury to neural tissue, damage to neural membranes will cause demyelination. Also, it disrupts normal development of neural systems. This results in craniofacial abnormalities as widened sutures, large anterior frontanel, and also this will cause profound neurological defects as hypotonia, seizures, and developmental delay. Also, accumulation of very long-chain fatty acids together with oxidative injury causes the most severe damage to the tissues with the highest peroxisomal quantity, and it's liver tissue where progressive oxidative injury causes fibrosis with hepatomegaly, simultaneously with elevation of transaminases, and damage to renal tissue manifests with development of renal cortical cysts that are present in 70% of affected individuals. So Zellweger syndrome causes severe injury to neural system, liver tissue, and kidney tissue. The second pathology called adrenoleukodystrophy. It's X-linked recessive disorder, so boys are in danger, and occurs due to a mutation in ABCD1 gene that disrupts function of adrenoleukodystrophy protein. The concept here is that on peroxisomal membrane located adrenoleukodystrophy protein, ALDP, and the function of ALDP protein is to transport very long-chain fatty acids into the peroxisome, where they will undergo peroxisomal beta oxidation. And the production of this protein is encoded by ABCD1 gene in DNA molecule. The problem is that mutation can disrupt the function of this gene, and this results in formation of dysfunctional adrenoleukodystrophy protein that in this state cannot provide transportation of very long-chain fatty acids from the cytosol into the peroxisome. Thereby, very long-chain fatty acids will accumulate in tissues, particularly in the adrenal glands and in the central nervous system, especially in the white matter of the brain. Now we see where the name of the disease came from. Adreno due to the accumulation of very long-chain fatty acids in the adrenal glands, and white in ancient Greek is leuko, so the second part tells about accumulation of very long-chain fatty acids in the white matter of the brain. Progressive accumulation of very long-chain fatty acids in the adrenal glands will cause adrenal insufficiency that at some point results in adrenal gland crisis. Accumulation in white matter affects neural system with progressive development of seizures, and both adrenal crisis and seizures eventually will cause coma and death. So adrenoleukodystrophy characterized by accumulation of very long-chain fatty acids in the adrenal glands and in the white matter of the brain. The third pathology called Refsum disease. It's autosomal recessive disorder. Individuals with Refsum disease are usually normal at birth, and symptoms usually begin to develop between the ages of 10 and 20 years old. Refsum disease caused by a mutation in PHYA gene that disrupts formation of enzyme phenethylCoA hydroxylase that provides alpha-oxidation of brain-chain fatty acids. It's exactly the enzyme that form hydroxy group on alpha-carbon. And in Refsum disease, this enzyme does not work, thereby any further metabolism of brain-chain fatty acids in the peroxisomes and in mitochondria becomes impossible. So the major problem in Refsum disease is disrupted alpha-oxidation of brain-chain fatty acids. To illustrate this, peroxisomes have specific enzyme phenethylCoA hydroxylase that makes them capable of alpha-oxidation of brain-chain fatty acids. And this enzyme is encoded by PHYA gene in DNA molecule. Obviously, if mutation in PHYA gene occurs, this results in the production of a broken enzyme that cannot provide alpha-oxidation. And as we know, the most common brain-chain fatty acid is phytanic acid that is found in milk and animal fat. Without alpha-oxidation, phytanic acid cannot be metabolized to pristanic acid, thereby phytanic acid begins to accumulate in tissues. And accumulation of phytanic acid with time will cause damage to neural tissue that results in development of ataxia, peripheral neuropathy and hearing loss. Also, it affects skin, it causes hyperkeratosis that manifests as scaly skin. Accumulation of phytanic acid also affects eyes and causes cataract and night blindness. And also, it causes developmental defects as shortening of the fourth toe and epiphyseal dysplasia. Because the most common brain-chain fatty acid is phytanic acid, and because in our organism we have very little amount of brain-chain fatty acids, by exclusion of dietary products that contain high concentration of phytanic acid as milk and animal fat, we can avoid progression of the disease. So the first option is phytanic acid-restricted diet. And the second option is plasmapheresis. The goal here is to decrease phytanic acid concentration in the blood. So Refsum disease is caused by accumulation of brain-chain fatty acids and affects neural tissue, skin, eyes and causes developmental defects.